Today, we will start discussing about the brachial plexus. What is brachial plexus and how it is formed? So, let's see. Brachial plexus. Brachial plexus is basically a network of nerves. I said network of nerves. That is a brachial plexus. Now, this network is present at the root of the neck and at the axilla. So, location wise, two terms have uttered. First of all, it is the root of the neck, and secondly, it is the axilla. So, first thing first, what is the root of the neck, and secondly, what is the axilla? Root of the neck is self-explanatory, that is the neck region of a human. So root of the neck is the lower part of the neck, and axilla is basically a pyramidal, to be more precise, the truncated pyramidal space, pyramidal means here approximately pyramidal space between the upper arm that is on one side, and on another side there is the rib cage. So in between them there is a space that is called the axilla. So brachial plexus, that is a network of nerve, it is by definition is present or occupying at the root of the neck and at the axilla. Tell you the same picture with this diagram. This is the root of neck and this is axilla. So brachial plexus, that is a plexus or network of nerve, it is present at the root of the neck and axilla. Okay, now how the brachial plexus is formed? The brachial plexus is formed by the ventral rami of lower fourth cervical and the first thoracic, that is the ventral rami of C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1 spinal nerves. So what is this thing actually? What is the ventral rami? Each spinal nerve, be it C5 or C6 or C7 or C8 or T1, each spinal nerve is coming out from a specific segment of the spinal cord. Okay, so for example, this is a cross section of a segment of spinal cord segment. Now from this segment a pair of spinal nerves are coming out by two roots. Only one of them has been shown, not both of the spinal nerves have been shown, only one of the nerves have been shown on one side. So let us talk on the nerve that has been shown. So it is coming out by the formation of two root. One is the anterior root, this is the anterior, this is the posterior. Another is the posterior root. So you can label it as anterior root and posterior root. Both these roots are coming out from this segment, and after they are coming out, they are basically uniting with one another. So these roots are uniting. Posterior root is also called the sensory root, and anterior root is also known as the motor root. Both these roots coming out of a particular segment are uniting to form the main nerve trunk. So this is the spinal nerve trunk. Okay. Now this trunk is subdivided into two divisions. One is going in front to supply the structure in the front half of the body and another is going behind to supply the posterior half of the body. So this is this division which supply the anterior half of the body is called the ventral ramus. Ramus in singular, in plural it is rami. Similarly, the division that is responsible for supplying the posterior half of the body is called the dorsal ramus or rami in plural, as I have already told you. Okay, so a particular nerve trunk, spinal nerve trunk, is divided into a ventral ramus and a dorsal ramus. Okay, now the same is true for C5, C6, C7, C8, T1. Here C5 refers to the spinal nerve that is coming out of the fifth cervical segment of the spinal cord. C6, it is the spinal nerve that is coming out from the sixth cervical segment. We know that there are 31 pairs of spinal nerves. 31 pairs of spinal nerves. That means there are 31 spinal cord segment. And how is the breakup of the spinal cord segment? We must know that. That is C8 or 8 cervical segment, 12 thoracic segment, 5 lumbar segment, 5 sacral, and 1 coccygeal segment. So all total, the number of spinal segment is 8 plus 12, 20 plus 5 plus 5, 30 plus 1, 31 spinal cord segment. Okay. Among them, the spinal nerve coming out from the C5 segment, C6 segment, C7 segment, C8 segment, and the T1 segment, they are ventral rami. Ventral rami of all these spinal nerves are forming the brachial plexus. Okay. Always remember that all the plexuses in the body, be it the brachial plexus in our case, or the lumbar plexus or the sacral plexus, all of them are actually formed by the ventral rami. So it is the ventral rami that always contributes in formation of the plexuses of the body, be it brachial plexus, be it lumbar plexus, be it sacral plexus. It is always the ventral rami of spinal nerves, not the dorsal rami, that are forming the plexuses. Okay. With that said, so we can now write the following things. First of all, regarding the definition of brachial plexus, brachial plexus is a network of nerve that is formed by the ventral rami, is the important keyword. Ventral rami of lower fourth cervical and the first thoracic spinal nerve. So root value is C5, C6, C7, C8 and T1. That is the root value of the brachial plexus. Now there is something important to consider. Sometime there is a contribution from C4. Sometime there may be a additional contribution with T2. If there is a contribution from the C4 segment, okay, it is called prefixed brachial plexus. Prefixed means the root value incorporate C4 plus others. That is the prefix type of brachial plexus. And in the similar vein, there is another type that is called post-fixed. Post-fixed type of brachial plexus denotes that there is a contribution from T2 spinal segment. So what will be the root value? C5 to T1 plus T2. So in the prefix type, it is C4 plus others, that means C5 to T1. In post-fixed, the root value is C5 to T1 plus T2. So these are the two different types, prefixed and post-fixed type of brachial plexus. Now, when we are commenting about this plexus is arranged in a particular way. There is a definite order in this apparent chaos. What is that order? Let's see and let's explore. See, apparently from the outside, it is a network that is a clumsy thing. But we can resolve this network into smaller components and we can orderly arrange them in an order. How this is going to happen? So let's see a schematic diagram. Okay. The brachial plexus consists of four components. Roots, trunks, divisions, and cords. Roots, trunks, divisions, and cords. Okay. So first thing first about the roots. Where are the roots? Now, roots are constituted of the ventral rami of C5 to T1. So in the context of a real life diagram, where are the roots? Roots are the first thing to come out, right? So let's use a different color. C5, C6, these are the ventral rami of the 5th cervical, 6th cervical, 7th cervical, 8th cervical and 1st thoracic spinal nerve. They are the ventral rami, remember, roots, okay? These roots, so how many roots are there? 5 roots. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There are 5 roots. C5, C6, C7, C8, T1, ventral rami. Clear? So that part is root. In case of prefix type, the roots will start one step higher from C4, and in case of postfix type, the roots will go one step down, that is up to T2. Now we have to see where the roots are located. So roots are located in the neck, that I have already told you. Now, to be more precise, let's take a look at a coronal section of the neck. This is a coronal section of head and neck, coronal sectional view. The roots are located deep to a muscle that is called scalenus anterior muscle. So let's see the scalenus anterior. This is the outline of scalenus anterior muscle. Okay, so roots are located deep to them, so we cannot see the roots. We have to see through this muscle to get to see the roots. So roots are like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. They are deep to the scalenus anterior muscle. Clear? Okay. Now, from the root we shift to the trunk. So once again, there are 5 roots. 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5 roots. Okay. The roots join together in a particular manner. The C5 and C6 first of all join. C5 and C6, both of them join together to form the upper trunk. So let's color the upper trunk. This is the upper trunk. Okay. C7 root alone continue downward at the middle trunk. So C7 root continue downward at the middle trunk. And C5, C6, C7, C8, T1. And C8 and T1 roots join to form the lower trunk. So they are joining to form the lower trunk. So how many trunks are there? There are three trunks: upper trunk, middle trunk, and lower trunk. So let's upper trunk, middle trunk, lower trunk. There are three trunks. Now, where are the location of the trunk with relation to the scalene muscle? Let's see the diagram on the left side. So previously I told you that deep to the scalenus anterior muscle, the roots are lying. So if I draw the roots by a dotted line, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the roots are joining together to form the trunks, three trunks. Now these trunks are coming out from behind the, from deep to the scalenus anterior. Okay, so as regards the trunks, let's again draw the scalenus anterior. The trunk lie in the neck and occupy the gap between the scalenus anterior in front and scalenus medius behind. So behind the scalenus anterior there is a muscle. The name of that muscle is scalenus medius. In front there are three scaleni: scalenus anterior, scalenus medius, and scalenus posterior, from in front backward. In between the scalenus anterior and scalenus medius, the trunks are lying. The trunks are lying in the neck, occupying the cleft between the scalenus anterior in front and scalenus medius behind. Clear? So let's draw the trunks. There are three trunks: upper, middle, and lower trunks. Okay. So roots lie deep to scalenus anterior. Trunk lie between scalenus anterior and medius. What is important to see is that both the root and trunk, these are the roots and these are the trunks. Both the root and trunk, both of them are lying at the neck. So roots plus trunks, they are lying at the neck above clavicle. Okay. So far we have discussed about the roots, trunks. What is left? There are two things yet left: divisions and chords. Divisions and chords. Now coming about the divisions. So after the trunks are formed, there are three trunks: upper, middle, and lower trunk. These trunks, each of these trunks, upper trunk, middle trunk, and lower trunk, they divide dichotomously into an anterior division and posterior division. So each trunk is divided into an anterior division, posterior division, anterior division, posterior division, anterior division, posterior division. Let's color the anterior division with blacks and posterior division with blue. So there are two divisions coming out from each of the trunk. Okay, root trunk. Each trunk divided into anterior and posterior divisions. Clear? So there are altogether 3 into 2, 6 divisions, because there are 3 trunks. So 6 divisions. So this part is the division. Clear? Now roots and trunks are located in the neck above the clavicle. Division, you can see, it is located down below, behind the clavicle. Let's clear the diagram. Divisions are present behind the clavicle. Divisions are behind clavicle. Okay. So root, trunk, division. So we can put like this. These are the 5 roots. C5, C6, C7. Okay, let's leave it. Let's put the diagram with respect to the axilla. Now the divisions are uniting between themselves in a specific manner to form the chords. So let's see the schematic diagram first. In this schematic diagram, we can see the roots being assigned a specific color, that is a violet color. Roots. From these roots, 3 trunks. This is the upper trunk, middle trunk, and lower trunk. And each of the trunk is dividing dichotomously into divisions, anterior and posterior divisions. Now let's color the anterior division in black. For example, this is the anterior division, this is the posterior division, this is the anterior division, this is the posterior division, again this is the anterior division, this is a posterior division. So what we get to see? What we get to see that the divisions are uniting in a specific manner. First of all, take this case. Here the anterior division, black is anterior division. The anterior division of both the upper trunk, sorry, let's give a specific color. Upper trunk and middle trunk. Upper, middle, this is the lower trunk. The anterior division of upper trunk and middle trunk, they join together to form the lateral cord. Okay. So this is the lateral cord. Similarly, anterior division of lower trunk, this one, it continues as the medial cord. And as regards the posterior division from all the 3 trunks, upper trunk, middle trunk, and lower trunk, posterior division coming out from all the 3 trunks, they unite together to ultimately form the posterior cord. So we get 3 cords: lateral cord, medial cord, and posterior cord. So root, trunk, division, cords. We get all these things. Okay. So in a nutshell, roots are 5 in number from C5 to T1. Trunks are 3, upper, middle, lower. Divisions, each of the trunk is divided into 2, so 6 divisions. And chords are again 3, lateral, medial, posterior cord. So that is the way the brachial plexus is organized. Now, in the region above the clavicle and behind the clavicle, in this region, that is the location of the roots, trunks and divisions. So roots, trunks are above the clavicle, division is behind the clavicle, and below the clavicle over here in the region of the axilla, here is the location of the cords. So roots, trunks are division, they are above and behind the clavicle, where are the cords? Below clavicle. Okay, so that is the basic about the brachial plexus. Now we'll discuss about the branches that are coming out from the brachial plexus. What are the important branches? It's a very important topic. Branches. So if we take the roots first, from the roots the following important branches are coming out. Roots are 5, C5, C6, C7, C8, T1. From C5, C6 and C7, these three roots come out a nerve that is called the long thoracic nerve. Long thoracic nerve. So having a root value of C5, C6, C7, it supplies the serratus anterior. There is another important nerve that is called the dorsal scapular nerve. That is coming out of the C5 root. Dorsal scapular from the C5 root. The dorsal scapular nerve, it is supplying the rhomboids. Okay. In addition to the long thoracic nerve and dorsal scapular nerve, the branches are given out by the roots to supply the scalene muscles and longus coli, and also contribution is given to the phrenic nerve. So long thoracic nerve C5, C6, C7, dorsal scapular nerve C5, rhomboids and levator scapulae, and also nerve to scalene. Also contribution to phrenic. These are the important branches from the roots. Now from the trunk, after the root we get the three trunks: upper trunk, middle trunk, lower trunk, upper trunk, middle trunk and lower trunk. We'll only discuss the branches from the upper trunk, because branches are coming out from the upper trunk only. Upper trunk. Let's see what are the branches that are coming out from the upper trunk. There are two of the branches, that is the suprascapular nerve, and this is the nerve to subclavius. Suprascapular nerve and nerve to subclavius, both are having a root value of C5, C6. Okay, suprascapular nerve supplies the supraspinatus and infraspinatus. It's important. It is supplying supraspinatus and infraspinatus, the suprascapular nerve. Whereas nerve to subclavius, as the name itself is self-explanatory, it is supplying the subclavius muscle. Okay. So roots and trunks have been discussed. Now let's coming out to the cords. Roots, trunks, divisions and cord. We skip the division, there are no such important branches from the divisions, and coming out directly to the cords. Now the names of the nerves coming out from the cords are very important. You have to remember it. Now we first go to describe the branches that are coming out from the lateral cord. Okay. Lateral cord. How the lateral cord is formed? Lateral cord is formed by the union of the anterior division of upper trunk and middle trunk. What are the posterior division? This is the posterior division of upper trunk, posterior division of middle trunk, posterior division of lower trunk in blue. So lateral cord equal to anterior division of UT upper trunk plus middle trunk. What are the branches that are coming out from the lateral cord? The branches which are coming out from the lateral cord, all of are having the following value: C5, C6, C7, and they are the lateral pectoral nerve, then lateral root of median nerve, and musculocutaneous nerve, three of them. All of them the root value having C5, C6, C7. How to remember this? First write C5, C6, C7, T8 and T1. Divide them into a lateral and a medial segment. So the lateral ones having a root value of C5, C6, C7. And the branches that are coming out from the medial cord, they are predominantly having a root value of C8 and T1. Okay. So lateral cord root value is C5, C6, C7. Done. Now coming to the branches coming out from the medial cord. What are the branches that are coming out from the medial cord? Let's clear it out. Medial cord. As I have already told you, the branches that are coming out from the medial cord having predominantly a root value of C8T1. So let's see. Medial pectoral nerve, lateral pectoral nerve from the lateral cord, medial pectoral nerve from the medial cord. Then the medial root of median nerve, medial root of median nerve. C8T1, okay. Then medial cutaneous nerve of forearm, medial cutaneous nerve of arm, medial cutaneous, okay, nerve of arm, medial cutaneous, okay, medial cutaneous nerve of forearm, nerve of forearm, all having root value of C8T1. And last but not the least, very important, ulnar nerve. Ulnar nerve has an additional root value apart from C8 and T1, that is the C7. It has a contribution from the C7, C8T1. So you see how to remember the root value of the lateral and medial cord. Now we are coming to the posterior cord. The posterior cord also gives out 5 branches. The lateral cord gives out 3 branches, medial cord gives out 3, 4, and 5 branches. Now regarding the posterior cord, it is also giving out the, there are 5 branches that are coming out from the posterior cord as well. Let's clear out the diagram and write about the branches that are coming out the posterior cord of brachial plexus. What are the branches? Number 1 is the radial nerve, number 2 axillary nerve, number C upper subscapular, number 4 lower subscapular, and number 5 the thoracodorsa. Now how to remember the branches that are coming out from the posterior cord? We can rearrange the initials of the name of the nerves, R, A, U, L and T. We can make it like, R, A, T, U, L, Ratul, that name we can remember. R for radial nerve, A for axillary nerve, टी फॉर थोराकोडोर्सल नर्व, यू फॉर अपर सबस्कैपुलर, एल फॉर लोअर सबस्कैपुलर. सो दैट इज ईजी वे ऑफ रिमेंबरिंग द पोस्टियर कॉर्ड. द लार्जेस्ट ब्रांच फ्रॉम द पोस्टियर कॉर्ड इज द रेडियल नर्व, हैविंग ए रूट वैल्यू ऑफ C5 to T1. सो द रूट वैल्यू ऑफ रेडियल नर्व स्पैन्स ऑल द रूट्स ऑफ ब्रैकियल ब्रैकियल प्लेक्स, दैट इज द C5 to T1. देन फॉर एक्सिलरी नर्व इट इज C5 C6. फॉर द अपर सबस्कैपुलर लोअर सबस्कैपुलर अगेन C5 C6 C5 C6. एंड थोराकोडोर्सल नर्व C6 C7 C8. Now what is important is that the supply of thoracodorsal is to the latissimus dorsi. Latissimus dorsi. There is a common viva question often asked. The upper subscapular and lower subscapular, both of them supply the subscapularis. Upper subscapular and lower subscapular supply the subscapularis. Ularis. And the lower subscapular alone, it supplies the teres major. Regarding the supply of axillary nerve, the axillary nerve supplies deltoid muscle and teres minor muscle, not major, minor. Okay, so these are the important points regarding the brachial plexus and the important tidbits about them. And next we're going to go on to discuss the different features that arise when there is an injury of the trunks of the brachial plexus. We are going to discuss about the Arbs paralysis. Arbs paralysis. We know that brachial plexus is made up of three trunks. Brachial plexus. Upper trunk, middle trunk, lower trunk. Upper trunk, middle trunk, lower trunk. Each of the trunks are formed by the following roots. Upper trunk is formed by the union of C5 and C6 roots. The middle trunk is the direct continuation of C7 root, and lower trunk is formed by the union of C8 and T1 roots. Each of the trunks thereafter divide into anterior and posterior division. Anterior division and posterior division. Anterior division, posterior division. Anterior division, posterior division. Now, injury to the upper trunk leads to Arbs paralysis. In other words, the Arbs paralysis or Arbs palsy occur due to upper trunk injury. Upper trunk injury leading up to the Arbs paralysis. The Arbs point is a region in the upper trunk of the brachial plexus where 6 nerves meet. We know that from the upper trunk, 2 branches arise. Number 1 is nerve to subclavius, and number 2 is supra scapular nerve. The abs point is a region where six nerves are meeting, and these six nerves are number 1 C5 and number 2 C6 roots, number 3 anterior division, number 4 posterior division, number 5 nerve to subclavius, and number 6 the suprascapular nerve. All these nerves are meeting in this region of the upper trunk. So this region of the upper trunk where six nerves meet is called Arbs point. In other words, Arbs point is the confluence of six nerves. The cause of Arbs paralysis is basically undue separation of head from shoulder. Now, it can occur due to the following reasons. Number 1, it may be due to a difficult childbirth or birth injury. Where you can see there is increased angulation between the head and the shoulder. So number 1 is birth injury. Next in line is due to fall from height on the shoulder, and during the falling of the ground there may be undue separation or increased angulation between the head and the shoulder. So fall from height on shoulder. And number 3, it may also occur inadvertently during anesthesia. By the anesthetic needle. In all of the causes, the resultant finding is there will be injury to the upper trunk, and that upper trunk injury will lead up to the Arbs paralysis. As upper trunk is formed by the union of C5 and C6 roots, hence any injury to the upper trunk will involve the C5 and C6 roots. So nerve roots involved are C5, C6. The deformity in Arbs paralysis has a specific name. The affected limb assumes a particular attitude which is called policeman's stiff hand deformity or porter's stiff hand or waiter's stiff hand deformity. The position of the affected limb in this diagram, the affected limb is the left upper limb. Is following. The arm hangs by the side, adducted and medially rotated, forearm extended and pronated. Arm adducted, you know, adduction means moving towards the trunk, and with respect to the shoulder, abduction means moving away from the torso. The forearm is extended and pronated. This deformity is known as policeman's stiff hand or porter's stiff hand or waiter's stiff hand. The following disabilities are occurring in case of arms paralysis. As the arm is adducted and medially rotated, hence the abduction movement of the arm as well as lateral rotation is lost. Similarly, as the forearm is extended and pronated, hence the flexion and supination movement of forearm is lost. These are the motor disabilities. Apart from the motor manifestations, the sensory manifestation will be in the form of loss of sensation. So there will be loss of sensation over a small area over the lower part of deltoid. Over a small area over the lower part of deltoid. So the disabilities are abduction and lateral rotation of the shoulder joint is lost, flexion and supination movement of forearm is lost, and loss of sensation over a small area over the lower part of deltoid. Apart from it, there is also another thing, that is the biceps and supinator jerks are lost. Muscles paralyzed in arms paralysis can be understood in the light of the disabilities caused. As abduction and lateral rotation is lost, that means muscles responsible for bringing out the abduction and lateral rotation of the shoulder joint in this context will also be paralyzed. The muscle that is responsible for executing abduction, that is the deltoid, and supraspinatus are paralyzed. The lateral rotation is brought about by the teres minor and infraspinatus. Both of them are also paralyzed. Regarding the disabilities in forearm and in radioulnar joint, as the flexion and supination are lost, with regards to flexion, biceps brachii, brachialis, brachioradialis, these muscles are paralyzed, and as supination is also lost, so with this regard, the supinator muscle as well as the biceps brachii are paralyzed. So the muscles which are paralyzed are as follows. We can sum them up: deltoid supraspinatus, teres minor infraspinatus, biceps brachii, brachialis, brachioradialis, supinator and biceps brachii. All these muscles are paralyzed. The brachial plexus consists of three trunks: upper trunk, middle trunk, and lower trunk. The upper trunk is formed by the union of C5 and C6 roots. The middle trunk is the continuation of C7 root, and lower trunk is formed by the union of C8 and T1 roots. Brachial plexus. Injury to the lower trunk will lead to clamp case paralysis. So clamp case paralysis occur due to lower trunk injury. So the site of injury in clamp case paralysis is the lower trunk. Now the muscles involved will be the same which are supplied by the C8 and T1 segment of the spinal cord. So muscles involved are those supplied by C8. C8 supplies the ulnar flexors of wrist and fingers. Ulnar flexors of wrist and fingers. Whereas T1, it supplies the intrinsic muscles of the hand. Cause of injury in Klumke's paralysis is due to undue abduction of the arm. Undue abduction of the arm. It can be seen when a person clutches something desperately by his or her arm in order to arrest a fall. Clutching something to arrest a fall. And also, as a result of birth injury due to inadvertent traction in the arm. Whatever may be the mode of injury, the result is always the same. There is hyperabduction of the arm at the shoulder joint. Deformity and disability in Klumke's paralysis. First one is the claw hand. This is the diagram of claw hand. The characteristic attitude of the hand is as follows: hyperextension of metacarpophalangeal joint, these are the metacarpophalangeal joints, there is hyperextension, and flexion of interphalangeal joint. So as regards the interphalangeal joint, you can see there is flexion. This is the proximal and this is the distal interphalangeal joint held in flexion. So that is the claw hand deformity. Next is cutaneous anesthesia and analgesia. It occurs along a narrow zone along the ulnar border of forearm and hand. So cutaneous anesthesia and analgesia is affecting this area. Over here. Along the ulnar border of forearm and hand. Okay. Number 3 is vasomotor changes. The same area which is undergoing cutaneous anesthesia and analgesia along the ulnar border of forearm and hand, that shows a warmth and dryness. Warm and dry skin at the site of sensory loss. The warmth is due to arteriolar dilatation. Arteriolar dilatation and the dryness is due to the absence of sweating. So these are the vasomotor changes: warmth and dryness at the region of skin undergoing cutaneous anesthesia and analgesia. Next is the trophic changes, number 4. Trophic changes. Long-standing case of Clumpkiss paralysis will lead to dry and scaly skin. The nails will crack easily. With atrophy of pulp of the fingers. And last but not the least, there is a particular syndrome that is associated with Clumpkiss paralysis, and that is called Horner's syndrome. Horner's syndrome. What is Horner's syndrome? Horner's syndrome is a collection of symptoms which occur due to involvement of sympathetic fibers. The sympathetic fibers which run through T1. As you know, in Clumpkiss paralysis, the C8 and T1 roots are affected. Now the sympathetic fibers that leave the spinal cord via T1 will also have a chance to be affected, and if they are affected, there will be manifestation in the form of Horner syndrome. What will happen? A constellation of symptoms which are as follows. Number 1, ptosis. Ptosis means drooping of upper eyelid. Next, meiosis. That means constriction of pupil. Then anhidrosis. That means inability to sweat normally. Next is the enophthalmos. Enophthalmos means backward or posterior displacement of eye in the orbit. And last but not the least, there is loss of ciliospinal reflex. The ciliospinal reflex refers to the dilatation of pupil when the back of the neck is pinched. So, in case of loss of ciliospinal reflex, pupil will fail to dilate. When the skin of back of the neck is pinched, so that is the Horner syndrome, which occurs due to involvement of sympathetic fiber that run through the T1, and it will manifest as ptosis, meiosis, anhidrosis, enophthalmos, and loss of ciliospinal reflex.